these orders. You know, I appreciate your presentation, Margaret, before, because when she helped me help you. Because in France, very often the vets, they phone to me because they know nothing about camel. And they say, ah, we have such symptoms. Say, you know, me, I spent my life in Africa or in Middle East. I know the disease in this country. But really, in France, I discover every day a new disease. Because it is metabolic, mainly metabolic disorders, because the people, they don't know how to manage the food and so on and so. And the animals, they don't know what kind of food they have to eat. So there is a big challenge for the scientists and for the vet. And what is the impact on the composition of milk? And everybody say, oh, the camel is very good for the health. But what will happen with camel eating only alfalfa twice a day? Is it the composition will be the same? I don't say the global composition, but the fine composition will maybe explain some dietetic or medicinal virtue. And also it's the same thing for the camel meat, maybe it could change. Yeah? So just a question regarding the metabolic risk. We pass from the diet, very diversified diet, to very monotonous diet. That is the first thing. We decrease the fibers in the diet also, in the intestinal system. We increase the intake. That is the important thing. Globally, in the grassland, in the desert, all the calculations that I have seen in the literature I do myself is between 1.8 to 2.2 kg of dry matter for 100 kg live weight, approximately. In intensive farm, you can go up to 3 kg, even more. So what is the consequence? So increasing metabolic disorder, acidosis, alkalosis, we have seen also, uremia, loss of appetite, infertility, and increasing of obesity. In French, the hump, it is la bosse. So I say obesity, because in fact, the obesity is only here, you know. And here in this photo that you can see here, it is a Wada camel from a camel farm in Saudi Arabia. It was a prince. He invited me to visit his farm because he said, I have a lot of problem on infertility. So I'm looking if there is problem with ovary and everything. But when I look the farm like this, he has 50 camel. You see the hump here, this one behind. So some years ago, I set up a score, you know, for the fattening, a score for the body condition score, okay? And we have six knots from 0 to 5. And here you have the Chamel, you know the perfume, French perfume, Chanel number 5. Okay, but here you have the camel number 5. Okay, it's exactly the same. The hump is so big that you can see only the hump and not the animal behind. So it's really a big risk, and I never seen obesity like this and in Saudi Arabia. Well, so now regarding the economical sustainability, what is the challenge for the camel product? First, the camel products are known for the dietetic properties, and I will make between brackets medicinal properties, raw and fermented. What happened with the processed milk is another question. It's true that it is high quality protein and low cholesterol product, especially for the population in the desert, is very interesting. We have new dairy product now, which is possible, cheese, yogurt, and a new meat product also. In Emirates, they have camel burger now, they make camel burger. I have seen in Morocco sausage and dried meat also, which is now in the supermarket. And it's possible also to have a good valorization of the leather and the wool. I will show you some photo. And also, don't forget the tourism and the leisure. And there is an aspect which is interesting, that the price of this product is very high compared to the product of the cow in many countries. So it means, finally, I think I have two photos of the leisure. Yeah. Leisure and tourism, racing camel and two to work in the desert. And the higher price, I think I have a table just to compare the price of the camel milk and the price of the cow milk in Algeria, Libya, and Egypt. I saw these three countries, and you can see the difference between the price between camel milk and cow milk. So it means the current product could be more profitable, even if the hygiene condition sometimes is not so good, but could be improved in many cases, because there is another legend. In many countries, the people, they say, oh, there is a lot of antibacterial activity properties in camel milk, so you let your camel milk at a normal temperature, it will not change. After, they say, but when I drink camel milk, I have sometimes I have some diarrhea, I say, because the camel milk gives diarrhea. I don't know, it's not the camel milk, it gives diarrhea. Look at, you have a lot of coliform inside. And it's a big problem, especially in Africa, to convince the people that the camel milk cannot be defense against coliform by himself. So, I will give you an example of camel milk and camel meat. Regarding camel milk, you have an emergence of camel dairy plants in many countries. Of course, for the moment, it's only a local market, except for Emirates that they have, they can export to Europe since recently. But it is interesting to see some example of organization of camel milk producers. In Mauritania, there is an industrial dairy plant with using camel milk, and they organize a producer. You have an integration of the camel sector in the national economy in this country. That is very interesting and very new. Development of the distribution network also, especially with supermarkets, what is available is in Kazakhstan here. And you have new products, and I just make a small bracket regarding cheese, because I work a lot regarding cheese, cheese camel. So it's been, we cannot limit the milk to the raw milk or even to fermented milk, which is a classical distributor to people in the southern country, but you can have different products. Of course, pasteurized milk, fermented milk, ice cream, white cheese, chocolate, it is chocolate, liquid chocolate with the milk, and cheese, that is a cheese I done in Saudi Arabia. And even I try to make a cheese like, you know, la vache qui rit, it's a French, okay, that is a camel qui rit, it's almost similar. So we can make a different type of product. And just to show you this, the initiative of Desert Farm, which is start from USA, and it is on their website, it's a copy of their website, and USA and in Western Europe, that you can see the farm, dairy farm, camel dairy farm, who propose a product on internet, okay? And you can see just, for example, raw camel milk, fresh, okay, $18 for 16 hose, I don't know, 16 hose is half liter approximately, I think. So. Yeah, okay, something like that. Okay, so you see, it's mean more than $30 for 1 liter. Okay, so well, good profit. Huh? Okay, so and this initiative is especially under the lobby of the parents of autistic infant. Because there is another discussion, I will not say the legend, because there is some people in the room who will say, yes, yes, yes. Okay, there is some belief that camel milk could be efficient for autistic infant, and there is a big lobby of parents of autistic infant, especially in USA, to develop the dairy farm industry. Just an example regarding camel meat. Camel meat is interesting because it's a regional market, which is very important, and which has stimulated the development of feedlot. Of course, the camel meat market is very low, it's 0.13% of the total meat consumed in the world. So it's been very, very few. But the growth, it is important, and it is higher than in cattle. And the market is existing, but it's partly informal, especially from the Sahelian countries to the north country of Africa and the peninsula. And I know now that Australia, you export some meat or live animal, or maybe from on carcass, due in Emirates or Saudi Arabia. So it means there is a really international market regarding the meat of camel, and you can find in Saudi Arabia camel meat really in supermarket. Yeah. I will speak about the health constraint, and just one information regarding the quality of meat. There is one parameter we sell index acid amino essential. Amino acid essential, it's in index, it means it's a percentage of covering your requirements as human consumer regarding the essential amino acid. And you can see the meat of dromedary Bactrian is higher than all the other meat. So it means the quality, the protein quality of camel meat is very important. And I can give also the example, I don't know if it's working here. I will try to... very small movie. But there is also a big increasing demand in a wool and in leather for the camel. So what is a camel, sustainable camel economy? So the camel economy will be sustainable if you integrate the ecosystemic service. It means what can provide the camel farming system for the environment in different topic. What is also the negative externality activities related to the farming, and how we can alleviate this negative externality, and to promote also sustainable business practice, including the policy of incentive price and tax on trade. If I understand, I have to accelerate. So last point is regarding the health sustainability. It means the control of transboundary disease. That is important point. I will not start about the vet aspect, but just to recall that the camel meat is a local market, but camel meat is a regional international market. It means there are live animals, we are crossing the border. And the sustainability of this movement is due to the safety of the commercial route. When you start from Somalia to Yemen, at this moment the safety is not very good. And the risk of transboundary disease. And for this disease aspect, there is a risk of disease because the camel come outside their environment. So they can meet something, you know. And also you have lack efficient veterinary service in exporting countries, many countries. And not necessarily because it is a thousand country. I just, 10 seconds, give you one example. In France, one farmer import camel from Canary Islands. The Canary Islands, the vets don't make the work properly, probably. And the camels, they come in front with trypanosomosis. Trypanosomosis by Trypanosoma evansi was never described in France before. In a place where it's a basin of Roquefort, when the place we have 1,000 sheep for the milk production. You imagine the problems that we have with the veterinary service. The public health risk also. Just recall the Rift Valley fever outbreak, which is occurred in 2000 in Saudi Arabia, due to the importation of sheep and camel from the Horn of Africa. And during many years, there was a ban of exportation by Saudi Arabia. And just recently, the MERS coronavirus. I know Australia, you are free of the MERS coronavirus suspected to be involved in the transmission from camel to human. And just to recall that because the risk linked to this disease, OIE in Paris has set up an ad hoc group of experts on camel disease to establish rule and standard. I am one of the members of this ad hoc group with other colleagues, and we have already published some paper regarding the official list of disease for the international trade. And last point, very fastly, what kind of camel in an urbanized world? How will it change? Yeah, this one. You know, you don't see, but there is two guys on the bike. There are two guys on the bike with the camel. It's a very good publicity for the bike, you know. Just to remember, the camel is an element of social prestige in many countries. It's an element of the securization of the farming system, especially faced to the climate change. It's a capital, very important capital for the family welfare, especially in poor countries. It's a long-term capital for people who are mobile. It's better to have a camel than to have an account in the bank. So it's been for many people the traditional life in the desert is something harmonious and relationship with environment, very good relationship with the environment. And even in the new standard of life in Middle East, you can see the people living in the town, and during the weekend they go in the tent, they have some camel in the suburban, and they stay their weekend with their camel in the tent. Even now, even if it is even in Qatar, where 100% of the people are urbanized. And the problem is we intensify the production, camel farming. Shall we able to maintain this relationship? Because despite of this change, of this intensification, modernization, the camel remain an iconic animal in many countries, in stamps, in statues, in bank, not everything. So there is an ambivalence in the relationship between camelids and the society. Policymakers, they are sometimes reluctant. The farmers, sometimes, most of the time, they are a good. They make idealization of their camel. Modernization support by developers. You have a renewal interest for the scientists, but the camel it is in this ambivalence topic. So, of course, the modernization is very important. It probably is. It is under our haze, but we must take account the sustainability of this new emerging camel disease system. And just to finish, some of you went to the last ISOCART conference in 2015 in Almaty, in Kazakhstan. Just to say that the next one will be in Morocco in 2018, and I invite you to come to this conference, and I thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you, but if that's all right, we didn't have another speaker behind you, so it didn't matter much. Thanks very much for your wonderful talk. We've got a short while for a couple of questions, I think, if there's any. Are there any vexing questions from the group? Phil.
Thank you. Bernard, you mentioned that climate change is pushing the camels south in Chad by 1,000 kilometres. Is that because the cows are unable to survive 1,000 kilometres south, and the camels are replacing the cows, or is it because what's the mechanism that is causing that shift?
In fact, it's something complex, because I observe an expansion of the territory from the, especially in Saharan countries. I live in Niger, for example. 30 years ago in Niger, you have the camel in the desert area and in Sahelian area. In the south part of the country, we call it Sahelo-Sudanian part, no camel, only cattle and small ruminants. But now you can find camel going down. You can find camel in Nigeria. You can find camel in North Cameroon. And even now they are in Tanzania, in Uganda. It's been a country before there was no camel. Why? Because first there is aridification of the milieu. And it's interesting because it is a camel who is going down, not the people living with the camel. It means, for example, in Niger. In Niger, you have camel breeders, Tuareg, Arab, Toubou, and you have cattle breeders, the Peul. Now the Peul cattle breeder, pure cattle breeder, they have camel. Why? Because due to the draft, the camel is a securization of the system. And you can see not only moving of the animals, but change in the farming system. And another aspect which is interesting, 20 years ago, you will never see a camel used for plowing. Now you can see camel used for plowing in Ethiopia, in India for a long time, but you can see even in North Kenya, you can see that now. So it means there is a change in the territory, is a change in the use, is a change in the owner. And that as I observe in the Sahelian countries. And in different countries, especially in Central Asia, we can see also the moving of the camel, not in latitude, but in altitude. For example, in Ethiopia it's interesting, because I was in Ethiopia maybe 25 years ago. I never seen camel, for example, in Addis Ababa in the highlands, or just to cross like this. Now you can see more and more camel climbing in the mountain and to up to 2,000 meter altitude. So it is a climate change. It is a change also in the farming system. It is a necessity for the owner to securize their production system. Is something like this complex, but the climate change play an important role due to the aridification of the climate.
We're seeing camels in places we never saw them before in Australia too.
Yep. Probably.
One more question.
Bernard, you had a slide up comparing the quality of the protein of camel meat to other meats. Can you tell me what the objective measure was that was used to determine that camel meat is a superior quality meat to the other animal species?
Regarding the graph that I show you. Okay, there is two things regarding camel meat. First is the cholesterol. We know that the camel meat is, I think with the kangaroo meat, probably, is one of the lowest cholesterol rate in the meat. Red meat usually hit by the human. Okay, that's the first thing. That I show is the index of amino acid, essential amino acid. It means it's a calculation. I can give you the website where we can calculate this. It's according to the essential amino acid you have in your meat. You can calculate the covering of the requirement of the human consumers. And it is additive intake for each. For example, if you cover 50% of the tryptophan, you have a 0.5 and so on, something like this. It's cumulative, and you can calculate an index. And this graphic, I publish it in a journal of composition analysis, because I want to compare dromedary and Bactrian camel. And in fact, when I see the result, and I have seen in the literature that the index seemed very high. So I compare, I take the composition in amino acid of different meat in the literature and make the analysis with what I found in a camel. And I was surprised to see, that the index was very high compared to the other meat. So we can try again with different environment and so, but this is a comparison with the literature.
All right. Can everyone join me again in thanking Bernard for coming along? And we've got a small present for you as well. That's right. You wish.